Welcome everybody to today's session. Let's start. Om Shri Narayana Parame Guruve Namaha. We will start with Deva Dashakam in Kannada with Vigyata Ananda Swami of Balyuttu Matha in Udupi district. We'll also be happy to know he'll be our first Kannada speaker next fortnight. So I would now like to request him to unmute himself and start us off with the Deva Dashakam.
Om Shri Narayana Parama Gurave Namaha. Om Rakshisu Nammanu Deva Kaipididu Salahu Deva Bhavasharadi Navikane Neenu Bhavashtava Charanave Nammana.
Thank you so much, Swamiji. I would now like to invite Amruta to come and do the Deva Dashakam, please. Amruta, if you could unmute yourself.
Om Shri Narayana Gurude Namaha. Deva me kaatu kullannil kai virasingunyangari Navikanni bhavati kyo ravikantoni ninpadam onunnayetniyani tottennum pozulum iya ninnilum drakku polunnam ninni rakspandamakanam anavasati mutati Tannu rekshichu nyangale, nanya rakuna nee onnu, tanne nyangu kutampura, aariyum thirayum kaathu, maruvum puri nyangalu, maayayum nir mahimayu, neevinu lilakanam, nee srishti vayadum sithi jaluvum, నీయల్లో దేవమి సృష్టికిల్లు సామక్రియాతను నీయల్లో మాయో మాయావియుం మాయా విరోధను నీయల్లో మాయే చికిత్సాయజినల్ మాయతు నీ సత్యం జ్ఞానమానంతం నీ తనేవతమానవం భూతం భావియుం వేదుడు ൂതപുതിയും മൂത്തിക്ക് അകവും പുതവും തിങ്കും മഹിമാവാതം പുകഴ്ത്തുന്നോ ഞങ്ങളു ഭഗവാനെ ജയിക്കുക ജയിക്കുക മഹാദേവ ദിനാനുപരായണ ജയിക്കുക ചിദാനന്ദ ദയാ സിന്ധു ജയിക്കുക ആരവേനു നിമ്മഹസാമായി വായനം നിത്യം വായനം വായനം സുഖം. Thank you
Amruta, thank you so much. Now I am honored to introduce to this second season of Guru Anugraham Guru Muni Narayana Prasad Swamiji to this evening's distinguished audience. Swami Muni Narayana Prasad is the guru and head of Narayana Gurukulam, a guru disciple foundation open to all, irrespective of nationality, gender, religion, caste, or creed. The Gurukulam aims at promoting the science of the absolute, or Brahma Vidya, as is known in ancient learning, as restated by Narayana Guru. A direct disciple of Nataraj Guru and Guru Nitya Chaitanya Yati, he has traveled widely teaching Indian philosophy as reinterpreted and restated by Narayana Guru. Before he gave up his worldly life, he was an engineer by profession, working with Kerala government in the Public Works Department after graduating from the very prestigious Trivandrum Engineering College. Muni Narayana Prasad was born in 1938 in Nagarur, Thiruvananthapuram district in Kerala. From 1960 onwards, he became an inmate in Narayana Gurukulam as a disciple of Nataraj Guru. Muni Narayana Prasad was initiated as a renunciate 25 years later in 1985 by Guru Nitya Chaitanya Yati. He has authored about 200 books in English and Malayalam. His English books are commentaries on Isha, Katha, Kena, Mundaka, Prashna, Taittiriya, Aitareya, and Chandogya Upanishads. Other major works of Guru Muni are commentary on Narayana Guru's complete works, which is in English and Malayalam, Karma and Reincarnation, English and Malayalam, Vedanta Sutras of Narayana Guru, Life's Pilgrimage through Gita, which is the English and Malayalam commentary on Bhagavad Gita, Basic Lessons of India's Wisdom, Garland of Visions, etc. A noteworthy work is the Vedantic Perspective of Gospels of the Bible written in Malayalam and English. In English, it is Christ the Guru, a Vedantic Key to the Gospels. Guru, over to you, Guru Muni Narayana Prasad, for today's lecture.
Om Guru Brahma Guru Vishnu Gurudevo Maheshwarah Guru Sakshat Param Brahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Before beginning, I should make a correction. I was introduced as having written more than 200 books. No, I have only written more than 100 books. And I was not born in 1928. I was born in 1938. Okay. Dear friends, this study group called Guru Anugraham is mainly meant to study Indian philosophy in general, concentrating more on Guruhood and also on Narayana Guru. I know this group is mainly concentrating on the concept of one world in these days. And also I came to know that many people are interested in knowing what Darshanamala is. So I thought I'll go through the overall nature of Darshanamala and then how it leads to the concept of one world. What actually is a Darshana? So, before beginning, I should make clear that I am not familiar with giving a class with the sense of time boundedness. That means I don't think of the limitation of time within which I should conclude the class. If I have that kind of sense in my mind, I won't be free, I won't feel free to think and say something. So if I don't find it difficult to if I don't conclude this class within the time limit of 30, 40 minutes, I think I will continue it in the next class. That is all. That is what I am familiar with. Okay. What is a darsana? Darsana means vision, seeing something. What is darsana mala? A mala or garland of visions. What is a darsana? Vision. Vision of what? We have visions of everything that we perceive. And we have visions of many things that we conceive in our mind. And also we can have a vision of everything that we conceive and perceive together. That means a vision of the ultimate reality that underlies what is perceived and conceived. That means the vision of the absolute reality. This absolute reality is called Brahman or Atman in India. And all the schools of philosophy in India are also called darsanas. Darsana in India is a word that means philosophy. So there are many schools of philosophy in India. So when we hear the name Darsana Mala, it is likely to think that, oh, this is a work that comprises the summary of all the schools of philosophy in India. No, it is not so. If you have a vision of the ultimate reality, how can we give expression to it? We can have an intuitive or inner vision of something and giving expression to it. Inner vision is an inner experience. And when giving expression to it, you will have to perceive it from some angle and present the view you have from that angle. How many angles are there from which we can view the ultimate reality? Even in the case of a physical object, a beautiful object, take the case of a very beautiful architectural piece like Taj Mahal in India. You can look at it from many, many angles and take pictures. All these pictures will be of one and the same Taj Mahal, but it will not be a complete picture of it. From all these pictures put together, you can have a sort of idea about what this Taj Mahal is. And there will be another experience that you get when you go directly and perceive it. That is another experience. In the case of the vision of the ultimate reality, Narayana Guru is a Nirshi who has perceived what that reality is. The word Irshi means a seer. That means a person who has seen. What is the reality? What is the thing he has seen? He has seen the ultimate reality. And when he gives expression to it, it will be by observing it from some angle. How many are the angles from which one reality can be perceived? How many are the angles from which the Taj Mahal can be perceived? Many, many angles are there. So too, in the case of the absolute reality also, many, many angles are possible from which it can be perceived. It will be from each point of view, you will get a different picture, but all these pictures will be of the same reality, but it will not be a complete picture. So what Narayana Guru did in the Darshanamala is trying to perceive the ultimate reality from 10 different points of view, and leaving the student, the seeker who makes use of this Darshanamala as a means for perceiving with his inner eye what that ultimate reality is. So from one vision or one darsana, you will not get a complete picture. Where is this absolute reality existing? Is it in the first darsana? There are 10 darsanas in it. That means Narayana Guru perceives the ultimate reality from 10 different points of view, and then leaves it to we seekers to arrive at what that ultimate reality is with the help of these different views or different visions or different pictures of the same absolute reality we get from looking at it from different or 10 different angles. Such is the way Narayana Guru created this work. Actually, it was written by Narayana Guru at the request of his disciple Vidyananda, Swami Vidyananda, by reminding the Guru that he had presented his own non-dual philosophy, the nature of his non-dual philosophy in the Malayalam language, and it was not written in Sanskrit. Sanskrit is the language in which Vedanta is traditionally studied in India. So the disciple wanted the Guru to put down this the philosophy that he represents in the Sanskrit language also. Then he asked the disciple, who will study it? That is, disciple said there will be people in the future to study it. So the Guru asked, are you willing to follow me with this notebook and pencil to take down whenever I give a dictation, the dictation of one verse? Yes, he agreed. Then he followed the Guru for many days, and Narayana Guru gave dictation verse by verse, and that was how it was written. And Vidyananda Swami, the person who took down the verses, he himself was the first commentator on this work, Darshanamala. Narayana Guru gave his words of blessings and named it as Deethi. So that book is available in Malayalam now. And Nataraja Guru wrote a very, that is his magnum opus, most important work, called the integrated, an integrated sense of the absolute. And this, it is based on this Darshanamala, but it is not a commentary on the Darshanamala, but the philosophy in it is represented as a science of the absolute, as it is known in the traditional Vedanta as Brahma Vidya Sarva Vidya Pratishtha. That means the science that is the basis of all sciences. Sarva Vidya Pratishtha, the basis of all the ones. There is one science that is the basis of all the sciences. So, Nataraja Guru, who wrote An Integrated Science of the Absolute, conceived this Darshanamala as a basis for creating a new science called An Integrated Science of the Absolute. Science of the Absolute is the English translation of Brahma Vidya. So Brahma Vidya is presented in the Darshanamala as a science that includes all the sciences, all the disciplines we human beings have. You know, our universities have different departments. Each department teaches a different subject. But we do not remember that all these subjects, all the sciences, all the topics of human interest, all these are different ways in which one consciousness, human consciousness, finds expression. So this one, what is the nature of this one human consciousness? That is the one can which is capable of thinking in a physicist way, that is capable of thinking in an artist way, in different ways. All these are different fields of are different ways in which one human interest, I mean human consciousness, can find expression. Or it is the all these are different functional facets of one and the same consciousness reality. What is that consciousness reality? That is what we call chit vastu. That is, chit means consciousness. Consciousness itself as a substance. That is Atma, that is Brahman. So the same Brahman, the same consciousness, same chit vastu becomes unfolded as various sciences. So with this perception, Rajaguru unfolded this Darshanamala into an integrated science, which is Brahma Vidya. That is the nature of the text called Darshanamala. Actually, what is the way in which the thinking proceeds or thinking becomes developed in the text? We know in Vedanta, which is Advaita Vedanta, it accepts only one ultimate reality. It is Atma or Brahman. But when we think of the reality, we think ourselves as real. We think the world we see outside as an object is real, and there should be an ultimate reality also, which we call Ishvara. So I am an individual, it's called Jiva. what I see outside is called Jagat, and the other is Ishvara, other ultimate reality. So all these three different realities existing separately, or are they one and the same reality perceived differently? This one reality alone that always exists, it is perceived from one point as Jiva, the individual person, individual being. And the object, that is the subject. And the object outside is the world, I see. And the ultimate reality is the absolute Paramatma or Ishvara, Allah, the Most High God, Jehovah. These are all different names in different languages signifying this one and the same reality. So are these three to be conceived as three realities? No. Narayana Guru says, Jiveshwara Jagat Bhedarahita Dvaita Tejase. That means, Tejas, effulgence or brightness, which is Advaita, is non-dual, where there is no differentiation between Jiva, Jagat and Ishvara. That means Jiva, the individual being, the world, Jagat, perceived outside, that means a subject and object, and the one ultimate reality that becomes unfolded as all these. So all these are to be seen undifferentiated, with no differentiation. Then only we have a perception of the non-dual reality. So where is this non-dual reality presented in the Darshanamala? It is not to be seen in any of these 10 chapters. 10 chapters are merely 10 different views we have of one and the same non-dual reality that we get from 10 different points of view. These points of view are called Adhyaropa, Apavada, Asatya, Maya, Bhana, Karma, Jnana, Bhakti, Yoga and Nirvana. So these are 10 different points of view strung together forming a mala or garland. Garland is something to be worn for beautification. This garland is also to be worn by a person who is wise. So this garland is meant for a wise person, and it has a structure of its own. It begins with Adhyaropa. Adhyaropa means acknowledging the existence of the actual world we see. Then we have to explain for how it was created, who created it like that. And then it goes forward, and the first three chapters can be seen as concentrating more on the sat aspect, the existential aspect. In Vedanta, sat, there are three aspects of one and the same reality conceived: sat, chit and ananda. The sat aspect is given primacy in the first three chapters. Chit aspect is given importance in the next four chapters, and ananda aspect is given important in the last three chapters. Seen from another point of view, we have already seen reality can be seen as having having three aspects: the seer or the jiva, the world seen, and the reality, jiva, jagat, and ishvara. Then from this point of view, the first five chapters of the Darsanamala can be seen as relating the world with the ultimate reality, relating the jagat aspect of reality with the Ishvara aspect of reality. How the jagat, the world, is related to the absolute reality. And in the second half, you can see how the individual is related to the ultimate reality or Brahman, or how a jiva is related to Ishvara. This mala, for making a mala, a garland, there's all these chapters, all these are to be thought of as beads. Beads are to be strung together, and it needs a thread going through it, unseen by anyone. So the absolute reality is to be seen as the unseen thread that combines all these chapters. Unless that unseen thread is there, no garland can be, no mala can be made. So that Advaita reality is to be seen as hidden by all these differently seen perceptions or visions. That is to be seen from our within, that is to be seen with our inner eyes. And how this mala is structured, we see the beginning of it, admitting the actual existence of this world, and the last chapter at the end of it, we see everything becomes just burned up in the fire of the absolute, attaining final nirvana. So these two ends are to be tied together to form a garland. Otherwise, it never becomes a garland. Unless both the ends are tied together, it never becomes a garland. So when you tie together these two ends, you feel that all these different aspects are, these different aspects have their own place within this one garland. And a garland always needs a pendant at the central point. And here in this mala also, at the end of the fifth chapter, you will see a pendant. It is Om Tat Sat. So that forms the very central pendant point of the mala. Sadevatat is, yes, Sadevatat. That is another version of Om Tat Sat. Sat Evatat. This is the way garland is structured. So if you go through all these chapters together, you will get a complete picture of different views of the same reality, and ultimately you find yourself one with this ultimate reality, which can be perceived from these which are perceived here from these different 10 points. But how many are the points from which one reality can be perceived? Numerous are the points of view from which you can see it. But no book, no work can present all the possible points. So Narayana Guru selected most important points of view and presented the view of the Absolute from these 10 different angles. And all these various chapters, what is it meant for? It is meant for enabling us to perceive the non-dual reality of which we are an integral part. Or very same, the one reality which finds expression as our own existence also, a momentary fleeting expression of that one and the same reality. The very same reality is that appears in the form of the world. The very same reality is what we conceive as the ultimate reality. That also is a kind of concept. We are not sure that such a God, such a Deva exists, but when we think of everything, when we philosophize, it becomes unavoidable to accept an ultimate reality. Thus, these three aspects become apparent, and that one reality that we can conceive of these in these three ways, or which we can visualize in 10, from which is visualized here in 10 points of view, which is possible to visualize in numerous points of views. And the very same reality is the non-dual one. That one reality is that becomes unfolded as all this. Is this world, is that reality one or many? This non-dual, it is one alone. It is neither Ishvara, the world, or Jiva. It is a non-dual one. And the world in which it appears, is it one or many? It is only one. And what is the status of a Jiva, myself? That is an integral part of that world. So the world, the reality, ultimate reality is one. The world in which it functionally exists, does that reality exist without assuming the form of this world? No. It is our own thinking that created these concepts of cause and effect. That reality never exists, can never exist as an abstract reality without assuming any form. So, the forms in which it appears, the absolute reality, the concepts or percepts we have of that reality, all these are to be seen as non-different. Actually, our own thinking is only a minute aspect of the function that takes place, a functional existence of the same reality. So is that world in which it functionally exists? So the world, the abstract reality, Brahman or Atman, are these two? No. the Atman reality exists in the form of this world. Without assuming the form of this world, no reality can exist. And without that reality existing, no world can appear to be. So these are not different. So the reality is one. The world in which it appears is also one. That is where the concept of the one world arises. So the world that exists is one. But in modern times, when we say the world, one world, you don't think of the real one world. We think of only the possibility of having a one world in the political sense. Politically, we have many, many countries now forming the world. But really, this world is one. How is this numerous countries, how does it exist? It exists only as an artificial creation of human beings. This globe, actually, when we use the word world in the Vedantic in Vedanta, doesn't mean the earth alone. It contains the entire universe, and our own concept of the world, that universe, and all the names that we give to everything that forms the world, all this put together is what we call the world. Narayana Guru, in the Advaita Deepika, at the beginning verse of it, says, பேராயிரம் பிரதிபையாயிரம் இங்கு விட்டில் ஆறாலெழும் விஷயம் ஆயிரமாம் பிரபஞ்சம். This prapancha, the world, is constituted of thousands and thousands of names, thousands and thousands of concepts represented by the names. And பேராயிரம் பிரதிபையாயிரம் and in thousands and thousands of objects outside. So all these put together forms the world. But in modern times, when we say one world, we just mean, oh, this world which has how many countries now? 189. I'm not sure how many countries are there. So how is it possible to have a one world when we have different countries in this world fighting each other for power or for their own benefit? So it is not in that sense we have to think of the one world. If you have the real concept of the one world, then we will realize that the concept of countries we have in modern times is a creation of our own ignorance. So if you think of the one world of the modern times in terms of politics, we have to admit that these politically conceived countries, they are all the creation of our own ignorance. So just vanish it, then we will find that this world is one. And that is how the world, one world concept comes as an outcome of Narayana Guru's vision of the non-dual reality. It is not thinking of the possibility of uniting all the countries together and forming one world. That is not possible. Even the United Nations is an organization in which it recognizes the independent existence of all these 189 nations. And it doesn't have any power over all these countries. It doesn't have any power to a decision-making power that can be applied to all countries. It can suggest certain ideas, but all the countries are free to take their own decisions. That means the United Nations has no power of its own now. But this United Nations is based on, really it is based on the notion of the variousness of nations, variousness of countries. What is the nature of this variety of nations, variousness of nations? Various lines are put over, drawn over the globe or the map, and then we think, oh, this is one country, that is another country. But you don't see any such line on the surface of the earth. You see that these lines only in our maps and globes. And it is for the protection of these lines, imaginary lines, just imaginary lines, no, never existing for actual as actual lines on the surface of the earth. It's for the protection of these imaginary lines. And the lines were created only because of our ignorance.
Okay.
It is for the protection of these lines that we spent a huge amount of our resources, sacrifice thousands and thousands of people. That is the result of the ignorance of ourselves, and it is this ignorance within us that is to be understood, that is to be vanished. Then only the real one world, the concept of one world becomes real. That was the concept of Nataraja Guru when he spoke of the one world. And he didn't ever think of uniting all the nations, presently existing nations, and creating an own world. World is already one. We have only to admit it. And the variety is only created by our ignorance. And only because of our lack of understanding, the oneness of the ultimate reality of which we are also an integrated part. I think this is enough. If any of you have any doubt about what I spoke of, they are free to come forward and ask questions.
I have a small, maybe I should speak in English.
Yeah, it will be.
I have a small that when you said that Adhyaropa Darsana and the Nirvana Darsana, these are in the garland, they are juxtaposed to each other. They are next to each other. So that tells us that the world and the possibility of realization is right there, right very close. Is that a unique presentation of Vedanta by Narayana Guru compared to or as opposed to other presentations of Vedanta.
Yes. This Darshanamala is a unique one. Even though it was written in the style of traditional Vedanta, the content of Vedanta he presented in it, the way in which he presented it is very unique. It is his own, and in the world of Vedanta literature, no such perception of the reality has ever appeared. It's a unique one. I didn't go into the details of each chapter.
Yes.
There is also commentaries available on Darshanamala. My own commentary is there, Garland of Visions, in English, and Darshanamala in Malayalam. And also there is the DCT Vyakhyana of this Vidyananda Swami available. I don't know, is there any other commentary?
The Psychology of Darshanamala.
Psychology of Darshanamala. Yes, that is in English. And I think that is all. It's a unique work.
I just wanted to confirm that and want to hear from Guru for everyone. Not only just for me, but everyone. So.
Thank you, Mr. Guru. I'd like to go next to ask you.
Guru, I am Sugita.
Sugita, yes.
Guru, are there any significance in arranging these darshanas in this way? Achyarabhu first, then Abhavada second, Asatya darshana third, Maya darshana. In arranging these darshanas in this way, is there any significance in this?
Yeah, there is significance. So you have to see, you have to go through all the chapters individually and then put together. Then only you will see the significance of arranging the chapters like this. The significance of arranging all these chapters in this way is it is very difficult to make clear at this point.
And Swami, can I just ask, what would you suggest would be the process in learning to read this interpretations? Would you suggest, I know Nataraja Guru's writing sometimes an interpretation to a lot of people is quite difficult. It's a different language and psychology he uses. But what would you suggest would be an introductory?
Okay. Darshanamala is not a text to be studied in the initial stage, even though it is discussed here. It is not a text to be studied as an introductory textbook. You have to have a thorough understanding of Vedanta, and then alone you will be able to appreciate the beauty and content of this work. Actually, if you take a course of study on Vedanta throughout your life, this will be the last text, not the first text. So don't worry about the difficulty you feel in studying the Darshanamala. It is felt only because you take it as the initial textbook. It is to be studied as the last textbook in Vedanta. So begin with, in my own opinion, I wrote a book called Basic Lessons on India's Wisdom. Malayalam with his Aravinda Adhya Pathangal. Study this and then you will become familiar with the way in which Vedanta is presented in general in India. And then you can, if you follow Narayana Guru's works, it is better to study Devadashakam and then study Brahma Vidya Panchakam. If you go through the commentary on the Brahma Vidya Panchakam, you will get an overall understanding of what Vedanta is, what are the problems dealt with in Vedanta, like that. And then you can study the Atma Upadesha Shatakam. In the meanwhile, it is better to study Viveka Chudamani of Shankaracharya also. You will become familiar with the traditional Vedanta. Then if you have more time, you can study some commentaries of Shankaracharya also. Only after all these, you can select Darshanamala as the last textbook. And of course, Atmopadesha Shatakam is to be studied, Bhagavad Gita is to be studied, and some Upanishads are to be studied with commentary. This is to be taken as the final textbook for your postgraduate degree in Vedanta or for your research work after the postgraduate studies. So don't worry about not understanding the content of Vedanta in the initial stage.
Thank you, Swami. You put my mind at rest.
Thank you. So next, I'd like to call Dr. Kamala Nikishna. Madam.
That's Swamiji. My question is actually, can we set all these 10 darshanas into Tattvamasi? Tattvam asi, whether it is possible.
There is no question of asking this, whether we can interpret
then, you know, this how is it?
Darshanamala in term as what is meant by tattvam asi. Vedanta, whether it is presented by Narayana Guru, Shankaracharya, or any other Rishi, they don't have to teach more than this one reality in which these dualities are cancelled out. So I shall tell you, go into, there is enough time, I can go to.
Salina, it was really wonderful starting with Vasant then on to Salina, Dr. Kamala, Unikrishnan. All the questions were so relevant, and how beautifully and how smilingly the Guru answered, and we all understood our place where it should be. In fact, I was wondering when he said it, whether he was just sort of indirectly, poking me, because I had made this special request that he should, though we are all jijnasus, we are just starting to study Guru. I said, why don't we go straight to the PhD book and start off from there and go backward? But how beautifully he explained, even a child, even a high school student could understand. He talked about the one ultimate reality, and not many, but one, the non-dual, can be perceived from many innumerable perspectives, innumerable viewpoints, he said. But Guru, in his last work, in his magnum opus, Darshanamala, has just looked at it from 10 points of view, made it absolutely clear. We at least understood from the outside what this is all about and the circumstances of writing the Darshanamala. Then those 10 different viewpoints, he of course presented in such simple language that everybody understood. People who are not, I'm not talking about the Jnanis in this group, but everybody, I think, even my daughter who you saw could not pronounce many Sanskrit words also would have understood, I'm sure. The world that without reality, another thing which he said and in such simple words is that the world, this one reality cannot exist by itself. It exists because of the world. The world exists because of the one reality. And we see it as innumerable realities. And we, you know, we are carried away by Maya, I guess. And he also talked about, so in such simple words, he talked about the nations. Many nations, world, many nations of the world are just the political sense. World is constituted of thousands and thousands and thousands of concepts, thousands and thousands and thousands of names, thousands and thousands of objects, but it is just one. And of course, he was saying that 189 nations, actually there are 195 nations if we include the UN observer states of Vatican and Palestine. But of course, it is a dream if the lines on the maps are maps and globe are erased, and like the earth, which does not have those lines, you know, globally we become one. Of course, it is not, it is just not even a distant dream. It is an unreal dream. The COVID brought in a new normal. And the world over, we follow very similar practices and follow very similar routines. But perhaps more realities will have to appear for us to just think about erasing or dimming the political lines and not invest in armaments, but invest in compassion, invest in love, invest in humanity, and in explore the possibility of negating nationality, caste, creed, religion, everything, and be one. It would be really wonderful. I was just talking about this, you know, I'm making a very simple paraphrase of how he explained this PhD level, as he said, postgraduate level, he said, philosophy, the last post we should access when we have read and understood, studied whole domains of philosophy.
I just want to thankfully acknowledge Guru. Unfortunately, he's not there. I'm not going through the Darshanamalas, Guru Darshanamalas in details, but I could understand much from his talks today. So I just want to say like this way, the Darshanamala is about unseen Atma, yeah, Paramatma, and it's the perspective convinced self by Guru and to convince others easier way. He also mentioned about the perspectives of a Taj. That perspective is an inward perspective, which we look from outside the Taj Mahal. That is the perspective about the Taj Mahal. But here about the Atma, it is an outward perspective. We all are inside the Atma. So it is an inside perspective. It's a vast, it is very difficult to understand because it is unseen item. So Guru has very technically made it in the Darshanamala to convince others in easier way. And in old, I think it may be Kano Upanishad, in Vishnu Sahasranamavali also, there are some methods mentioned to about this darshana, about this Atma or Paramatma, whatever it may be. I just want to recite that is like that. Yogo jnanam tada sankhyam vidya shilpadi karma cha vedaha shastrani Vijnanamedatsarvam Janardana. These are the various methods to reach to this Atma. So this is also one way of perspective or darshana itself. Thank you very much. That's all.
Madam, I think, thank you,
yes, Vinod, sir. I would be grateful if you thank the Swami, yeah, as well as...
definitely, yes, sir. So firstly, I would like to thank Vikyananda Swami for giving that initial Devadasham, that two lines in Kannada to start the session. So thank you, Swami, for that. And we are looking forward to hear from you next week in Kannada. That is one. And second, yes, definitely, yes, we all waited for Swami. I think definitely there is a technical issue because we are not able to reach Swami too. So his presence itself was a great blessing for all of us. And the topic he covered it in, that how the time went itself, we didn't realize that the way he took the session. And we will look forward that how we can have him in one more session in down the line. So madam, we request you to initiate that, because definitely it will really add value, his presence here and the way he was putting across topic. So that's, thank you. So Swami is not here, but on behalf of Guru Anugraham and on behalf of all of us here, we would like to thank Swami for his presence with us today and giving the time and sharing his knowledge and his thing to all of us. But before closing, I would like to thank Jija Madam for organizing such a wonderful platform. Today we heard from a member, one of the participants from Goa, that they also want to be part of it. We are definitely open to it. And we have these sessions every fortnight. So next one should be on the 5th of December, but the details will be shared very soon in the group. So Jija Madam, thank you for having this wonderful session on fortnightly in English. And before closing, I'd like to thank Yamuna for the wonderful introduction. And behind the screen, we have a couple of people like Shaj and Anup, who's been streaming this live. So thank you, Anup. Thank you, Shaj. And on behalf of Guru Anugraham, I would like to thank each one of you for being part of this. And definitely, yes, our key motto is to ensure that the teachings of Guru is taken forward in the best communication way, that is by in English, because in Malayalam and other language, Malayalam especially, there are many platforms. So that is one of the reasons Jija Madam took this initiative, and we will take it forward in the coming sessions forward also with all of your support. So thank you very much, and Guru's blessings and prayers to each one of you. Thank you.